So Bert, you know, if you'd like to start out with how you know, become an honorary Indian, just start out with that.
I own a motel.
Yeah, you did. You know,
I'm here to figure out how to get this thing really humming.
Exactly. So you figured, like, you know, he got into the motel business in quite a years before. You're a pioneer then too, right? So before the Indians took over, so you had to learn from them.
Absolutely. Right. I do. My wife's family business is, you know, it was three days in motels. That's humor, but also true.
But that the experience working at those motels gave you some of the best, you know, business lessons that you ever learned in your life, right? So, you know, if I recall correctly, I mean, you had a great motel business. You and your wife jumped into the business with the family and then realized that you had to do a turnaround very quickly.
Yeah, my wife and I were working in New York, whatever, what was this, 1981. We were both working for Time Inc. I was working for Home Box Office, producing the comedy and variety shows back then, and my wife was working for Time Magazine. And we got a call from her family's accountant and lawyer that they wanted to meet with us, and they came up to New York and met with us. And long story short, you know, the family business needed some new blood. If you remember, interest rates back then had gone to 21%. Prime was 21 or thereabouts. And my father-in-law had built three motels with a prime plus four construction loan and no takeout. And he built his first one a Days Inn, having been a sole proprietor of a single location furniture store, that he was the principal salesman at all. Typical family business, he was a salesman and his wife did all the books, you know, out of a shoebox. And then they met Cecil Day down here in Atlanta, got enamored with that, built a motel, opened it to 100% occupancy. It was just slamming, 100% occupancy. And then they decided that was so good, they would build two more. So they had three of these things going, and motels two and three opened with no occupants, or no significant, 20 or 30% occupancy, and then motel number one dropped to about 30%. Why? No one went out to the parking lot and checked, you know, the red mud factor on the tires and on the cars in the parking lot. They were all construction workers building a power plant down the road from motel number one. Power plant finished. Oops. So that was the scenario that their advisors came up, and like so many family businesses, it had two pay scales in it, owner and minimum wage, and no one in between. So we moved down there and lived in the back bedroom with my in-laws, you know, with whom I'd probably spent 6 hours total, including the wedding. And we lived for 2 years in the back bedroom, you know, running the family furniture store and the motels. And you know, I've got my MBA from Virginia, and theoretically I've been trained in business, but there was no substitute for meeting payroll with no cash in the bank. Once you've learned how to do that, everything else in life looks simple. And since then, you know, that was, you know, 10, you know, housekeeping staff and a couple of motel managers and two delivery guys for the furniture stores. And that was my payroll, or our payroll, that we had to meet. So that was a small number of zeros. You know, the problems I face now have more zeros in them, but they're no more acute than those were. So I've said the best MBA I had was, you know, was meeting payroll with no money in the bank in those motels. And, you know, at times I was the housekeeping staff, and I can make a bed as good as anybody here in this room. I can run the front staff. I can deliver furniture. I can put down carpet. I can hang mini blinds. Fast forward 5 years later, my wife and I were in this business with the family for about 2 years, and luck would have it, interest rates went down, we refinanced, occupancy went up, things got a little bit better, and some of the other family entered the business, and then there was too much family in the family business, so we moved on. I came down here and started, came down here to Atlanta, went to work for Ted Turner, to help launch CNN and be the head of marketing there, another fascinating entrepreneurial experience. And then eventually started my first broadcast group, let's call it another 4 years, and I bought a television station in Charleston, West Virginia. And my partner was Norman Lear. That was my financial partner. And another gentleman here in town, Sam Ayoub, who was the former CFO of Coca-Cola. Those were my angel and investors for Act Three. We bought a television station in Charleston, West Virginia, and I took Norman in there for a big party event, for all of our advertisers. And I'm sitting at the head table with two of our biggest advertisers that were, and he and his wife were the biggest auto dealer in Charleston, and Norman Lear and a few other notables there. And the wife was just looking at me, our client's wife was looking at me and burning a hole in my head. And I could see her going, I know you from somewhere. I know you from somewhere. And eventually I had to tell her, I installed the carpet in your living room. So never burn a bridge is another lesson you learn. Always do your work right. You never know when it'll come home to haunt or help you.
Bert, that's awesome. I mean, so, lessons learned. Mm-hmm. One, know your customer, right? That's good. Second, when you're selling something, don't give the other party too much time to think. That's what you did with your wife's family before you got married to her. You only spent 6 hours with them. So,
and fortunately they did not know me before they recruited me.
Meeting payroll, without loans, without the kind of financing and other things today,
there were funny stories there, but we, in the motel business, you build up, and particularly in West Virginia, all your tourists come for about 4 to 5 months, and then you have this long winter, and there's nobody. So you got to stockpile cash in the summer, and then make it through the winter until the occupancy starts turning around. And Mrs. Hicks, my wife's mother, she had her hand clamped down on the checkbook, and we introduced her to Merrill Lynch money market accounts, which, prime was 21%, so the money market accounts were paying 18% or something like that. Wish we could have that again. But she wouldn't touch that. She wanted that money in a checking account. She thought there was something wrong with that. We got her to move the money into this Merrill Lynch account. And then once she got that first month statement with the interest, she wouldn't write a check for anything ever again. Just nothing. You couldn't get her to write a payroll check or anything. You just had to tear it out of her hands to give up that interest. All funny stuff.
So Bert, you were an entrepreneur in college, but you didn't have the benefit of TYE and no entrepreneur training in high school like we do with our kids over here.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the lessons learned was you became an entrepreneur in college, and you essentially, instead of taking loans, and contributing to the student loan debt crisis that we're coming to, you actually paid for it college through your entrepreneurial experiences. Mm-hmm. So
yep.
Share some of those wild stories and experiences.
Yeah, I had a partial scholarship to Virginia, and not enough to cover all the expenses, but I was paying my own way through school, and I spun tunes for fraternity parties. I flipped burgers at a little place in Charlottesville called the White Spot. I did a number of those kind of things, but what was my biggest payday there? I convinced. And it's hard to believe that this is, the political correctness meter has moved so far since then, but I convinced the state of Virginia, the University of Virginia, and the Board of Visitors of the University of Virginia that college kids need to drink beer and the University of Virginia, now that was not a revelation, but the University of Virginia would not allow the food services to serve any beer on the grounds, as we call the University of Virginia. So there was no beer allowed anywhere on the grounds or near the grounds. And my theory was, because beer was not available, and nor any other alcohol, that kids would either do something worse, or they would drive somewhere away from the university and drink grain punch or other things. So my argument was that if you had beer on the grounds, kids may, you know, may drink beer, but at least they would stumble home as opposed to drive home. That was the argument. And back then they had 3.2 beer, which was in the drinking age was 18 for 3.2 beer, you know, which was lower alcohol content, and 21 for anything else. So I convinced them that if the food services couldn't do it, let me do it. So I had the concession to sell beer on the University of Virginia for my last 2 years. And to this day, I still think I had more cash at any given time relative to what I could spend it on than any day since. So we served beer, and it was all the honor system. You drew a beer at kegs I put around, you know, the university at three different locations every week, and you pulled a 12-ounce glass of beer, and you threw a quarter in literally in a shoebox on top of the kegs, and it was all honor system. We didn't have to check IDs, because the honor, you know, you had to be 18 to drink. The incoming classes were 95% 18 or over, was the stats. That's what the state ABC board agreed to, and they agreed that the honor system was significantly strong at the University of Virginia, that kids under 18 would not pull a beer unless they were 18. So that's how it worked. And I think the strategy was strong. It worked great for me. I still think it should be deployed again on campuses around the country. A lower alcohol beer. I mean, you can drink a lot of 3.2 beer and you get full, but you don't really get wasted. And I think it's a lot better than either the alternatives. And I won't lecture, but that's how I got started, and that and other things. And I thought I was going to stay in Charlottesville and be a bar owner and do other things, book entertainment and all. And then my parents prevailed on me to go get a real job. So I went to work for a bank. Started from there.
And then you landed at home box office, HBO?
After I went back to business school, you know, I wanted to go back and do the entertainment thing. Did 2 years of banking, then went back to Virginia to do my MBA and booked concerts to work my way through on the MBA. So I used to book concerts for a number of different schools, you know, the rock concerts and all that type of stuff. And wanted to stay in the entertainment business, and went to work for Home Box Office, which was still called Home Box Office, not HBO. It was called Home Box Office back then, and it was still touting the Pennsylvania Polka, which was one of their original shows back in 1979 when I went to work for them. They hadn't exploded onto the scene.
Bert, like running concerts in school really helped you have a major breakthrough when you're at HBO to go, when you're thrown into negotiating a deal with one of the largest pop stars, music stars in the world at that time. So, you know, would you recommend, like, you know, the kids here and some of the young folks who are, you know, who have are some of the folks who have kids in school, should they all organize concerts so that they pick up some skills?
Well, that's one thing you can do. That's harder to do now, but I think, you know, what Ty is doing for entrepreneurs, what, you know, Raj and I do with investing in entrepreneurs is something that is, you know, we should celebrate. And my continual speech to anybody young is, you know, or old for that matter, you can be an entrepreneur at any age, but I'd like to get them started as early as possible, is you have to be willing to fail. You have to, you know, and, you know, failure is not bad. You know, failure is bad if you lied, cheated, or stole. As long as you don't lie, cheat, or steal, failure is a learning experience. You know, don't fail the same way 2, 3, and 4 times in a row. Learn from it. But you know, not many people launch their first gig as Google. Yeah, so you know, that's the way it works. But I think anything you can start, anything you can try, and in college, high school, grad school, or anytime thereafter is worth doing, and I encourage that all the time.
But you know, going in your career, I mean, you know, not everything was a smooth ride. In fact, you know, you had some, you know, amazing, you know, great successes, and then you had an amazing, you know, you thought you were on the verge of success on one deal, you know, when you started your entrepreneurial venture after you got done with Turner, you and your partner had a big fundraiser, and you had a, you know, an event where your partner had a situation, so to speak. I'll let you explain that. That really, you know, flipped the business plan when you're trying to launch it. This is Broadcast Equities.
I left Turner when I joined Turner. CNN had just been launched and was not sure that it was going to make it, and or whether Turner could survive the cash consumption that CNN had created for the whole Turner Enterprises. But I was there for 2+ years there, and literally met one night at some type of function a gentleman who was financing startup independent television stations with Reg D limited partnerships, and he met me and saw my business card that said Turner, and I was head of marketing at the time for Turner, which was a department of one. It was a huge department, and so he figured I knew television. He said, "Why don't you buy my company that does these Reg D partnerships?" I said, "I'd love to. Just a little bitty problem. I don't have any money." So he convinced me that I could earn my way into buying it, you know, and I did, long story short. And we financed 8 startup independent television stations. This is in 83, thereabouts, that age, 83, 84. Remember back, hearken back, you know, the landscape for broadcasting and cable were, you know, 3 television stations in a market. There was an ABC, NBC, and CBS, and a public television station. And very few cable channels. You know, home box office had just started to really become big. So cable was probably 30 or 40 channels back then. CNN hadn't really become the marquee channel it was. It was on its way. So the independent television station, or the fourth station to sign on in the market, was an independent. There was no Fox Network or CW or any of the others back then. So I was. That the company I bought was called Seashell Media. I changed it to Broadcast Equities to give it, I thought, a little more, you know, status as a name. And I bought that, or started it. We did 7 or 8 partnerships to put brand spanking new television stations on the air, and they were all individual startups, and you know, this gentleman was doing one, and this lady was doing one, and this one, but they were all doing their first startups, and there was no learning curve. Everybody was making the same mistake with their startups because they weren't doing a second or a third one. They were all doing their first. And the way we structured these partnerships, I was managing partner of the financial side, but not of the operating side, so I didn't get to tell them what to do. And that was fraught with problems, so I put together a plan to roll all these stations up into a master limited partnership, which was still a financial vehicle that had, you know, that had emerged as a very vogue tool of the day. And I had raised all the money for these Reg D limited partnerships. These were $50,000 units. From a network of broker dealers around the country that put their clients into these deals. They weren't big tax deals. I mean, these weren't like 10-to-1 tax write-off deals like the cattle deals and all. These were 1-to-1 tax write-off deals, with the premise was the television station would work and we would pay you back 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 times your money from the sale of the station. But these stations weren't working on plan because of they were all individual. So anyhow, we put a plan together to roll them up. But I needed a management team to do that. So I went all over the country recruiting a management team, and I recruited a gentleman named Gene Adelstein from Phoenix, Arizona, who had put two independent television stations of his own on the air, raised his own capital, put them on the air, and sold them to a company called Providence Journal. So he'd gone the full cycle. He had the perfect bio, and he didn't like raising money. So I would raise the money, and he would operate. So we put together a company to do this, and invited on our nickel 200 broker dealers from all around the country to the breakers in Palm Beach to have a big session and to explain to them the new plan, because they still needed product to sell to their clients. So this was going to be good new product with a better plan. We had a Saturday morning session, 3-hour session to explain our plan. You know, I explained the financial, Gene explained the operating side, and then we were going to break for golf and tennis and all that kind of stuff and have a big party that night and, you know, rah, 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 and send everybody out to raise the capital for us to do this and roll all the stations up. All the stations had agreed to roll up. Now, I teach one or two classes a year in entrepreneurism at various places, and this particular case I teach a lot because and I'll explain the business plan and all that kind of stuff, and then I lay it out to the audience, you know, that we did this presentation for 3 hours and almost got a standing ovation. I mean, everybody loved the plan. And we broke and high-fived and went to lunch, and then I leave it there, and then you say, all right, you know, this was all the good stuff. Now, let's think about all the things that can go wrong and plan for that in this thing. And nobody ever guesses what went wrong.
Actually, why don't we ask the audience a question? What could go wrong?
What's the worst possible thing that could go wrong? Well, you won't get it, and if you did, you probably wouldn't say it out loud. My partner, Gene Adelstein, died in my arms at lunch at 12:15. Now, try and figure that one out. You know, the tragedy of me having to be the one to tell his wife and his kids, you know, that he had died. He having called all them between 11:30 and 12 to tell them how great the meeting went, and then having to, then what do you do? I mean, there's the tragedy and all that stuff, and then what do you do with the business? And you can't just say, I didn't need the operating partner. I can do that. We had set the whole business up. Now you have to go find another operating partner. We couldn't do that. We had to abort. The financing vehicle, the public limited partnerships, they fell out of vogue within a couple of two or three or four more months because of changes in the cycle. So that begat Act Three, which I put together then to do a C Corp, and I went out and raised money from Sam Ayoub and here in town, and then Sam wanted to do some of it. We needed a bigger one. And I knocked on Norman Lear's door, found him and got him when he had just sold his company to Coca-Cola and had a lot of cash looking for something else to do. So the point of that is you can't give up. And you just have to get back off the ground and get back in. All those 200 broker dealers that, I'd flown into the breakers, about the time I was figuring out I got to restart again, all those bills for all their airfare and all their hotel rooms and everything else came home to roost, which damn near bankrupted me. But we kept them on hold long enough to raise enough money to roll it into what became Act Three, and that went very well. We rolled all those stations up into a different vehicle, betting on the emergence of a fourth network, which my business plan for Sam and Norman was that I thought Paramount would be the fourth network, and premised on Star Trek, that would be the key program of a fourth network, the marquee program. Paramount was making all the noise they were going to do it. They whiffed, and then along comes this guy Rupert Murdoch, who bought the Metro Media stations and So we were the largest group of affiliates at the launch of the Fox network, and that worked.
Then Act 3 was your first major success. You got it sold for $500 million. Then you didn't do what most people in the South do, is go retire and say, I'm done, play golf and buy a boat and buy a beach house in Florida. Mm-mm. You went back right after that and started Ellis Communications.
Yeah, I had a non-compete for a bit when we sold it. And, you know, we sold Act 3, and then when that expired, you know, so I tried, you know, did a couple of other things, and then started another broadcast company. You know, television's been betty good to me, so I did it again, and started buying television stations with a new management team I put together, and met a company, an investment fund called Kelso in New York, which I've been now a special limited partner of ever since. And we started buying television stations in a tight geographic area, different business plan, the Southeast. Tried to get as many television stations and tried to buy the number one television station in a market to get the best newscast, and put as many of those together as tightly focused as possible to get some synergies in the region, a corporate synergy versus, you know, all these separate television stations. And then felt like we needed proprietary programming, and there's nothing more proprietary in the Southeast than SEC and ACC football and basketball. So I bought a company called Raycom, which was at that point in time, it was even bigger than ESPN. It was the biggest producer of college sports in the nation. You know, it produced at that point in time, the football and basketball for 7 of the 8 conferences, and was trying to get a lock on all of them. But we bought Raycom and put that in there, and so we had great programming and some great stations, and thought that was going to be a long term play. But David Bronner from Alabama decided, with the Alabama Pension Fund, decided that he wanted to own it more than we did. So he bought it from us, and that's now called Raycom Media, which is one of the largest group owners of television stations in the country now, headquartered in Montgomery.
And that was $850 million?
That one worked too, that one.
Yeah, Kelso. That was awesome.
Kelso and I did very well on that one, and we sold that one to Alabama.
You see, account for inflation, you already had two unicorns. Done.
I don't think they were unicorns. They didn't ramp up. Our hockey stick was nice, but it wasn't that way.
Yeah. But it's still, you know, almost $1 billion sale, you know, account for inflation, all that.
They worked.
So, and then now you have two successes, lots more money, you're investing in entrepreneurs. Then you decided to get back in the actor game.
Yeah, I decided on top of those two successes, I needed a massive failure. I worked hard to create as big a one as possible, and we spun out of Ellis Communications. We spun out our little internet group. I had bought a little company called Creative Video here in Atlanta from two wonderful entrepreneurs that I've done a lot since, and think the world of them. But we bought little Creative Video into Ellis Communications to do presentation videos for ourselves and for clients, and to do, you know, our fledgling websites. And, you know, again, harken back when websites was the state of the art in the internet at the time. And our television stations had really cool websites. And cool enough that our clients, our auto dealers and other advertisers, started coming to us and say, can you build our website? We need one. So we took what was a cost center for us, a very small cost center, and started leasing them out, renting them out, and that became a nice little business within Ellis Communications, something that Alabama David Bronner didn't want any part of. So we agreed to take that out of Ellis Communications and rebranded it as IXL, which stood for Internet Excellence. And Kelso and I put $20 million into that company, in, let's see, that was 96. And it had 10 employees and less than $1 million of revenue, but we thought we could grow it. And between 96 and 2000, and the second quarter of 2000, we grew it from, you know, about 10 employees to over 6,000 in 59 offices around the world, and doing in our, we peaked at a market cap of close to $2.5 billion. And the second quarter of 2000, we did close to $250 million in revenue that quarter and $30 million in profit, and then the world fell apart. And you know, and most of you know the history, and most of you here remember the big sign on the interstate for our headquarters, which was where SCAD is now. And the end of 99, we went public. We went public in September of 99. The stock peaked in first quarter at about $57 a share. So it, you know, it had been a great run, and it was a lot of fun. And most of our offices had, we had run out of space in five or six of our really big offices: New York, London, San Francisco, LA, Atlanta, in particular, and in Sao Paulo, and a few other spaces that were smaller, but the same thing. So we were adding 300 and 400 net new hires a month. Now, net new hires meant you had to replace the 20 or 30% of your staff that were leaving every month to start their own companies. So you had to replace them and then hire another 300 or 400 to handle the growth, which was coming in. I mean, we were knocking down some really big contracts. I had three companies alone that paid us $10 million a month for services. And so you're looking at your space. And space was at a premium. You had to buy new space, lease new space. You didn't want to lease space that you were going to outgrow the next month, and then have a lease that you couldn't use. And you didn't want to have people all over the city. That didn't work. And then you had to put in the air on chairs and the free soda and all of the foosball machines and the beanbag chairs and the meditation rooms and. Which we're all doing again, by the way. So we had to do that, and you know, and we opened these offices that were had enough space to handle at least 2 or 3 years of growth if you're doing a 5-year lease. And then boom, you know, you started cutting back. So we went from, over the next year, we went from from almost 6,000 employees to 6,000 employees down to 600. And we went from 6 practice groups down to 2 practice groups, and the principal one I focused on was travel and transportation, and we were amongst the best in the business there with 2 huge contracts from Delta and British Air. And then along came 9/11. And 9/11 was the final death knell for IXL, because our two biggest clients went from $10 million a month to zero in a matter of a week. And we couldn't survive that. So that the rest of that history, we sold the remnants of it. I tried the best to maintain the carcass of IXL and keep as many people as employed. We sold IXL to Razorfish, which got bought by Microsoft and spit out of Microsoft. But and there's still some IXLers floating around in Razorfish, and there's a lot of IXLers that are out with their own companies, and some have gone on to huge success. And Nir Shah, you know, who is the founder of Wayfair, is our biggest successful IXLer, and a pure multi-billionaire right now with the success of Wayfair. So we have a lot of great alumni, and it was a great experience. It just didn't end the way I would have loved to have ended it. But you learn a lot from that too.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained.
But what most people don't know, Bert, is that you were so passionate about the company, you never sold a single share.
Well, that's one way to define it. I was also so stupid that I just... My partners at the time, Kelso, was not a venture fund or a technology fund. They were a traditional buyout fund. And our strategy and then was we bought a company and we ran it as best we could until we sold it. And when we left, we turned the lights out behind us as we exited. But we exited, we were the last person off the boat. Everybody else went through the door before us and then we came around. So we didn't sell until everybody sold. So Kelso, whose position was, their 20 million was worth several billion, and my position was worth a lot of money too. We never sold a single share in the primary or any of the three secondaries we did, because we didn't think it was right for us to sell. And it was maybe laudable, but financially it was, we all look back and say that was dumb. I mean, our strategy now is when the cash window is open, get the biggest net you can through the window. So we have a different strategy now about a company. We still think we should take care of all of our fellow investors, but that doesn't mean we can't participate at the same time. So we all learned a lesson. And back to my initial thing about entrepreneurs is you can't be afraid to fail. Kelso uses me in particular before they make, and Kelso's a $7 billion fund, and they buy a lot of plain Jane manufacturing and other companies, not particularly big in technology, they've done more since, but they don't ever, and they love to do, they only do friendly deals with management, and they like to do buyouts with management, but they, whenever they're getting close to management, the first person they tell the managers to talk to is me, because they want their managers to know that Kelso's a good partner in good times and bad times. And Kelso has financed me several more times since, even though we failed miserably on IXL. They think the experience that we went through, that nobody launched their own lifeboat, nobody left anybody behind. We went in together, we left together, we made arguably a very dumb decision together, but we made it together and we did the best we could. And so they like entrepreneurs to know, or managers to know, that Kelso's there in good and bad times. And back to that same class I teach, my message to a lot of entrepreneurs is, pick your partners well, and good partners are better than bad partners. And how do you know a good partner? It's easy to be a good partner when all you're trying to do is whack up a big pot of cash in the middle of the table. It's a lot harder to be a good partner when you've hit a real brick wall. That's when you test the mettle of a partner, a colleague, a friend, whatever. It's a lot more fun to be successful. I will say that.
Bert, so after that, you went back in, did your next deal, Ellis Communications, and then you built that back and successfully sold that. Then you started Ellis Capital a few years ago.
No, I'm saying Ellis Communications. That was sold before IXL, and that is now Raycom. I kept the name, did IXL. And then Ellis Communications exists again now as a group of, we now have another group of 15 television stations. Again, television was Betty, Betty good to me, so go back to what you know. And I've got a third strategy for television. We have bought television stations now. Ellis Communications, one, we bought the best television station we could in markets. Now we try and buy the crappiest television station we can in really big markets, because I'm not buying them for the television business, I'm buying them for the underlying spectrum. And we've aggregated spectrum in the top 10 markets, which now the government is, through the the FCC, is trying to acquire spectrum back from television to repurpose it for wireless. And television spectrum is the best spectrum for wireless. It's got the best propagation characteristics to penetrate walls and go up and down over terrain. So broadcast spectrum is going to be repurposed to the wireless folks through a voluntary auction. And if that works, which is supposed to happen next year, then the stations we bought for, you know, $1 for their, you know, as really bad television stations, or low-end television stations, however you want to define it, you know, are worth $100 for their underlying spectrum. And we'll see whether that works. But that's my day job. We run those television stations, and then we've been buying them, and now we're managing the process leading to the spectrum auction, which I could regale you on the nuances of that for hours. You know, but it's a very complicated thing, which looks like it's now going to happen. I've been involved in writing the initial legislation to set up the auction. And that's what I'm doing as a day job. And then Ellis Capital is my fun job. And we do a lot of venture investing in a number with Raj and KP, and would love to do more with, you know, with Ty and anybody and everybody in this room. You know, we like investing.
Awesome. And you've done 100 plus deals, and you're the only investor in town that invests with entrepreneurs who have had a failure before, if they didn't lie, cheat, or steal.
Oh, failure is a great character builder. So failure is not a negative in my view. And I hope it's not a negative, and it's not a negative in my biggest backer, which is Kelso, and it's not one in mine either.
I just want to reiterate, again, Bert, I wasn't kidding when I said that earlier. Bert was one of my mentors when I first became an entrepreneur, a CEO, 20 some odd years ago. There was only a handful. He was one of the ones that willingly went into his pocketbook, was an investor in a couple of my companies. One was very successful. He had a great return. I think your portfolio with me is up, but there was a failure. But I want to talk about one thing and ask you to just address it quickly. One of the things that I've always been admired about you and your family is, in spite of the success, you work as hard as anybody I've ever known, yet you always give back. I would like you to take a moment and talk about how you find time and why do you do that. It's not just entrepreneurs, but when you think about the number of philanthropic causes that you're supportive, it's been a model for me. So thank you. But if you could take just a minute and talk about that, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you, Karen. No, that's very important to me. I don't want to leave this world with the biggest boat and the fastest airplane. You know, I'd like to have done something else. Mentoring young people is something I do a lot, and investing and mentoring young people, I like to do. My wife and I decided a long time ago, well before the billionaires started giving their, you know, 50 or 90% pledge, that we did not want to use whatever money we might have to deny our children the right to be successful on their own. So we are not leaving a lot of money to our kids. Now, our two children and their spouses are never going to live in a box under a bridge, but they're going to have the ability to set their own tone and set their own careers and make it or break it on their own, with the addition they will have a beach house that, you know, we didn't start off with. So, you know, they will have a better situation, but we're going to have a lot of money, I think, to give away, and that's what we want to do with it. You know, my causes, you know, used to be higher education, you know, in the University of Virginia and all. I personally think college has gotten way too expensive, you know, for the product that it produces, and there needs to be a change. And one of the ways you change that is alumni withholding their dollars. So I'm doing that. That's my personal little soapbox. But, you know, I'm very interested in the environment. So I serve here on the Riverkeeper, you know, the Chattahoochee Riverkeeper, which I've been involved in for 15 years and think it's a fantastic organization. I'm chairing their capital campaign right now. So if any of you are so inclined, come on up and find me. I am on the board of the San Diego Zoo, which is maybe one of the best organizations in the entire world, not only for the entertainment value, but for the number of things they do around the world to preserve various species and maintain the vibrancy of our world's environment. I'm now on the board of the Atlanta Zoo, and I have done a lot of stuff with church and the other things. But so we are always looking for ways that we can use our money for something better. And I continue to redo our will to set up a family foundation that we hope to give it all away before we. Before we have get run over by that proverbial bus. But whatever we don't give away, it'll be up to our children to do so. But thank you, Garen. Good.
Mr. Ellis, it was an absolute delight hearing you talk. I'm actually in the media arena. Mm-hmm. You and I have achieved a little different level of result, but I'm making a living at it. But I'm just interested in general. What's next for you? And maybe more importantly, how did you make that decision? What was your criteria for deciding what you were going to do next?
It's very spontaneous, and serendipitous. There's no master plan. Each day I get up and get excited about something new, and I've tried a lot of things that, that have not materialized into anything that that looks big. The biggest play, as I was explaining briefly, is the Spectrum play, and that one has the potential to be my biggest payday and biggest success. It is nowhere near played out yet. It still requires government to do something that with a lot of litigation and other things that could intervene, but I can't even tell you how that one came about. I've forgotten how it came about, quite frankly. But it was one of the several of us were sitting around trying to figure out where the money to be made in broadcasting would be with all the fragmentation that was occurring to the traditional advertiser, with so many different places to go and the migration to digital. That what else could you do with television properties, which I knew how to buy. You get to know your industry. I think I know pretty much every owner, every group, every significant player in the business, and have had some experience with them, mostly positive. So I had the network to do something with it. I just had to figure out what to do with it.
Well,
there's a lot of other plays I've got in there that may also materialize, which we're working on. So you keep a portfolio, and part of my ADD is just to have a lot of things going and then focus on the ones that rise to the top of the heap.
Well, I for one am going to be watching and on the edge of my seat, and going to be doing everything in my power to emulate what you're doing. Thank you again for that. We've got our first question back here in the back. Yes, sir.
Bert, Raj, thank you for this fireside chat this morning. Bert, a question for you. One of the things you mentioned at the beginning of your chat was one of the best experiences you had was having to make payroll without having any money. And you said that was more valuable in the MBA. My question is, when it was getting to that point, I'm sure fear was setting in on how you would make payroll when you didn't have money available. How did you overcome that fear to make payroll?
You just didn't have a choice. How do you overcome fear when when you get pushed out of the plane? You got to open the chute. There's no choice. Payroll came every 2 weeks, and pretty much every Monday after we made the previous payroll, we were down to ground zero again, and no money, and you just had to go scrounge it. And you could get people into your motels, but you really didn't have much choice. We put up billboards, and we couldn't afford billboards. We couldn't afford to go lease billboards from other people, so we went into the billboard business. My brother and all, I still have billboards, that we learned everything about Kirkcott and Axe, and we went out and leased property and put our own posts and post holes and made our own billboards so we could get people into the motels to get revenue. We could get revenue from the furniture store, which was right next to our little office. And so if we could find somebody that would buy some carpet, then I would take my coat and tie off and put on what looked like a white lab apron, and I'd go deliver carpet. And I'd install mini blinds, and I'd deliver furniture, and we'd do whatever we want. We just ran back and forth. You did whatever it took. That's the only way. There's no course that says you do this, this, and this, and this. You just do all of them.
Bert, thanks for being here. Over the course of your career, what one thing has changed the most, and why does that matter? And what one thing do you believe has stayed the same, and why does that matter?
What thing has changed the most? Well, if you're in the technology space, the way you finance a business and how you manage the growth and the exit of KP and I were talking about here earlier. I mean, is the exit for a technology company your Series A now? I mean, is that how you exit? The Wall Street Journal just talked about the IPO market for technology companies is very poor right now because so the financing has changed radically. I'd say, to give you an answer without, that's probably the thing that's changed the most is how you finance them. What hasn't changed is you just have to be doggedly determined, to make a company work. And you just have to get up every day and say, whatever happened yesterday, today's a better day and I'm gonna make it work. And, woulda, coulda, shoulda, you have, as I say, you start off with a Google that just, it hits on all cylinders right off the bat, but that is not what you can expect.
Hello, Bert. So that was very inspiring. We appreciate it. It was a lovely story to hear all the details of a glowing career. The question I have is, how does a mom-and-pop operation who has no experience with executive team building go to the next stage? What are the two or three of you few things that you would suggest to make that big transition?
I think the COVA program does that, but Bert, that's one of our mentoring programs for companies like that. But
I'm not sure I understood the question.
So let's say there's a small operation, a mom and pop operation, the owners don't have much exposure or experience with team building, and they want to transit to the next stage, the next level. There is opportunity, there is market, but execution is a challenge. How does a company transit? What kind of things that can be done?
Okay, so you have mom and pop business, mm-hmm. And they have a huge market opportunity and they want to figure out how to grow, but they have no experience with executive leadership or anything on their staff. How do you go about putting that together? I mean, that's why I was saying that's a COBA program, but we'd love to get your insights as well on that.
Well, first and foremost, you have to figure out you need help, and that's the hardest part for if you're talking about a mom and pop or a small individual entrepreneur, whether it's mom and pop or what, is to figure out that you can't do it all. And that's very, very hard. The hardest thing for any entrepreneur is to learn how to fire yourself and replace yourself with somebody that can do what you think you're supposed to be able to do, but hire somebody that can really do what you're not doing. And to learn when you have peaked, when you need to step aside. So if you can mentor or help somebody understand that if they want to take it to the next level, I am dealing with that very, very, very thing with one of my portfolio companies right now, where the CEO does not realize that he is failing and won't step aside I think, you know, I'm going to have to fire him because he won't step aside, and that's going to be tough. But I got to do it for both of us. And then I'm dealing with a company that wants, you know, that's got a, you know, huge market opportunity, and but they're too small to do it. And, you know, it's going to be a national opportunity, and they've got to realize that to go, that they, that this is a business that's going to, that's going to play out in the next 6 to 12 months. And if they try and do it, you know, as a small operation, shoestring operation, you know, they've got a small lead right now, but they're just going to get trampled on. They do not have anything proprietary to protect their position. They've got a lead, but the only way they will exploit their lead is if they run faster than anybody else. And to run faster than anybody else, they're going to have to raise capital and staff up and go for the brass ring, or they will just stay as what I call a little Jewish deli. They might be able to make some good sandwiches and pay for themselves, but they'll never realize the dream.
Hey, Bert.
KP, so, you're not allowed, but anyway.
They gave me the mic. So
here's the closing zinger. I'm ready.
So let's not call it a bubble. Let's say maybe it's a cycle. What patterns do you think entrepreneurs are repeating that were not great during the dot-com? Like, what are the negative patterns that we're repeating that you see, and what are some of the positive things that we've learned? You know, I don't have any Aeron chairs in our office, but, you know, what are you seeing? What patterns being repeated and what's not?
Well, right now, in many of the companies, it just looks like there is no limit to the amount of financing you can get, and there's no need to be profitable. It's just a land grab, you know. And I will never buy an Aeron chair again, you know, except on eBay or someplace used. I gave away so many of those damn chairs when I was closing down IXL. Yeah, and I hope to never buy a foosball machine again. But you know, we're doing all that same stuff again, and I think it's necessary. We're all recruiting from the same pool of smart people, and they have lots of options, and lifestyle and environment and office environment and the like are very important. So you have to compete, you know, or you can't. I think what we're doing, if you really go to the nth degree, which I will not, is ludicrous. I think we're, the values that we've got for companies, particularly on the West Coast, I don't think it hasn't gotten that way here, you know, on the East Coast and or in Atlanta, but it's coming this way until or unless there's a correction. But I think the values for private companies are way too high. And what we had, you know, hearkening back to IXL, when we went public, everybody just said, grow the top line. That's all. Don't even worry about the bottom line. Just grow the top line and try and reduce your turnover. Try and get that down to 20%, you know, and grow the top line as fast as you can. And then one quarter into our IPO, our post-IPO, the world said, now you got to be profitable. You know, those were inconsistent things, but the shield went, the gate came down. I mean, it crashed down, and we made a lot of profit, you know, in our second quarter of 2000. But then another lever came down that we couldn't survive from. But any day now, I see the lever coming down that says all these companies that are just land grabbing are going to have to be profitable, and I don't think they're going to be ready for it. I think there'll be a huge correction on that too.
So the message is, wait, you're going to have a furniture sale very quickly. So
I think the message is be profitable.
Be profitable. Last.
Yeah, Bert, as you look back today, and it's obvious you've taken a lot of risk in business growth and so on, what gave you the maximum satisfaction, and what was your greatest downfall?
Maximum satisfaction is the number of people that have worked for me that have had a life-changing monetization
as a result of the way that we've allocated stock, you know, whether in my broadcast companies and or in our technology companies. A lot of people in IXL did sell stock. I was one of the idiots that didn't, but there's a lot of them that did, and I take great satisfaction that we made a lot of people enough money that they could do what they wanted to do. Biggest failure is IXL. I mean, that, you know, they having to take that sign down on the connector was quite painful. I was at a event at Westminster where our children went to school, and they had a technology evening, and of course, you know, I was part of that, and this was after the IXL sign came down, and they had a speaker whose name I've forgotten, but his whole speech that whole night was how some of these companies, you know, had been run so stupidly, and he was talking about that dumbass company that took that big sign down on, and I had introduced him, and he just never put the two together. So you're sitting there in the audience with all my friends looking at me going, what are you going to do about this? Just, you move on, just live and learn.
All right, thank you again, Mr. Ellis.